there's nothing that the coronavirus doesn't touch.
We've all seen Black Lives Matter demonstrations.
Oppression is brutal.
So unfortunately, because I just feel like we're going down this road, we've been down this road before.
Hello and welcome to Your Voice. My name is Gabriel Renum. Yesterday, President Trump left the White House for the final time and flew to his Florida resort, Mar-a-Lago. But what did President Trump leave behind? Here to talk about his legacy, I have today's panel, journalist and broadcaster Tech Kofi, journalist and broadcaster Afir Adom, and journalist and political analyst Ahmed Caballo. Guys, it's a pleasure to have you with us today. Let's talk about Trump's legacy. I'm going to start by asking each of you to say something positive about Trump's presidency, starting with you, Ahmed.
The positive thing about his legacy is it unveiled, unmasked the nature of elements in US society that many had hoped were no longer there, that we lived in this sort of post-racial utopia because they elected the first African-American president, and what Donald Trump did was reveal that actually, you know, these elements are there, that the neoliberal policies that have been practiced by Bill Clinton and were proposed by Hillary Clinton when she stood in 2016 were no longer acceptable to those in the Rust Belt, what they call the flyover states. And what Donald Trump was actually an anti-establishment kind of vote and showing that we will no longer be forgotten. I don't necessarily agree in the way that they demonstrated their anti-establishment feeling, but nonetheless, it's a discussion that will continue. And while Trump has gone, Trumpism hasn't.
Afir?
I think one of the main things for me, and you have to be honest, there are a few positives that have come out of the Trump presidency. You know, we narrowly avoided World War III. He started the space race again, which hadn't been done for many, many years. But Trump got voter participation up to the highest levels that it's been since 1908. So you had 66.7% of American adults voting in 2020. We have not seen those numbers, like I said, since 1908. And that resulted in the highest voting numbers you've ever seen. So 73 million or thereabouts votes for Donald Trump and nearly 82 million for Joe Biden. So if there's one thing that he did, probably like what you said, Ahmed, is that he got people voting. He got people engaged in politics. Maybe that's not what he meant to do. And that was a byproduct of his very divisive policies. But if you're going to get more adults engaged in politics and engaged in democracy, that's got to be a good thing.
I mean, Afir just rightly pointed out that there was a huge increase in the political participation and voters, and that included Black and Latinos. What's your view?
Well, absolutely, and we can't deny this. The man polled 74 million votes, which is more than the votes that actually put him in power the first time round. For me, like Ahmed said, I agree that Trump delivered two great wins for America. First of all, he held up a mirror for America to see itself clearly. He shone a light into every dark corner of their society, because you can't have the world's most powerful nation living in denial of who and what it is. Actually, Biden came back and said that this is not who we are. I beg to differ. Donald Trump showed us exactly the extent and the depth of racism and white supremacism in the United States of America. Now, the flip side of that is that Donald Trump gave us a working knowledge of what democracy actually is, because none of us here have had to fight for democracy. It was given to us on a plate. We were born voting. People did not understand before Donald Trump that democracy doesn't cook itself. Democracy doesn't look after itself. It's got to be nurtured. So bully for him for showing Americans that if you take your eye off the boil, off the cooker, you will wreck the food.
Right. So how should Trump be remembered, Afir?
I mean, he should be remembered for definitely making people more divisive about the color orange, for a start. He should be remembered as that one-term president. And again, going with what Ahmed said, he shouldn't be remembered as a blip. He should be remembered as actually what America really is. And it should be a starting point and a point for Americans and American democracy to feel that they should never go back to. I don't think anybody really wants to relive those 4 years and all the things he did. You know, when it comes down to just the fake news of rhetoric, there's just so many things I can't even get into it. But, you know, his parting speech was just so typical Trump, claiming to do things that he hadn't did, taking credit for the economy, for the vaccines, as if he was the one in the lab actually in with the little dish doing everything. You know, it needs to be a lesson. But people shouldn't think that it was an unnecessary blip. It was going to happen. Right. And 4 years was enough. And people should think, we do not need to go back there. And what can we do to advance and make sure that we don't go back to that point? Mm.
So, Ahmed, did Trump really unleash a brand of politics that has never been seen before?
Yes, 100%. In the sense that he never seemed to be on the retreat. No matter how much he was attacked, no matter how often he was involved in a scandal that would take down any other US president, he was always on the forefront. And what I've seen, if I compare it to British politics, someone like Jeremy Corbyn, who was always on the defensive, it shows that no matter what the media establishment are saying about you, if you take a forefront or an offensive step, that means that you'll shore up your base and you'll energize your supporters. So there's something to be learned from Donald Trump in that sense.
So let's talk about his base, because his base, Donald Trump's base is a mixture, because you had the militia, you had QAnon, you had all these spaces. So do you feel like Trump actually adapted his, you know, his rhetoric according to the base and what the flavour of the base was at the time?
I think Trump was a master of one thing, going for the lowest common denominator. Trump could walk into a room and figure out that this is what pushes this person's buttons. Mm. And he wouldn't mess around with anything else. He'd go straight for the thing that triggers people. And two things triggered people in America. One, the fear that America was not looking white enough anymore. And that was exacerbated by the fact that the people in the Rust Belt, who up until then had been relatively well off, suddenly discovered that their privilege, their white privilege, was under assault. Secondly, the other thing was that Trump realized that if you looked after your friends, they would look after you. And you can see this in the way he's done the pardons and so on and so forth. Now, as a result, what have we learned? We've all learned that politics is a lot more complicated than the way it seems on the surface, and that unscrupulous leaders can lead you on a merry walk.
Wow. So Ahmed, is there any such thing as alternative facts? Because this and fake news, because I know this has been one of Trump's legacies, that fake news, alternative facts. What does that mean?
See, I actually like the fake news thing. My only concern is we've kind of give a bit of a tribute. I hope we're going to get to the bad stuff as well. Mm. But I actually like the fake news because on the street, here in the UK, in the US, there's a lot of mistrust in the mainstream media, and we never saw that articulated from those in power. We kind of saw this unholy alliance between the corridors of power and the media establishment, and there would be in these WhatsApp groups and these press conferences would be organised. It was nice to see somebody take on the CNN, the MSNBC, these kind of liberal media establishments, who many people hold in the same esteem as the Fox Newses and the right-wing media establishment, and see them as two cheeks of the same backside.
Wow, fake news. So let's talk about Donald Trump's ban on Twitter. Now, to many people, that was a welcomed outcome. Mm-hmm. But to general people, that sets a certain precedent. What are your thoughts?
It's a difficult one because social media was always supposed to be this space where anybody could say anything that they wanted. And that is the point. So, you know, you're not always going to come across people saying what you want and what you like unless you're a social media bubble and you exist in an echo chamber. And unfortunately, you can't really do that. You do have to be able to take on and look at other people's opinions. And I think that's what social media should be. I think where it becomes problematic for Trump is that he tried to sell his opinion and his version of events as facts. And that's problematic because you cannot try and package your opinion as proper facts. That's not going to work. Yeah. And I think that's what the social media giants, the YouTubes, the Twitters, Instagrams, the Snapchats took umbrage with, is the fact that he was making up whatever he wanted and wanting that to be fact. And unfortunately, you can't do that. I think it's a shame that he wasn't further policed. And I do think it's a shame that we are quelling voices and banning people from social media, because as far as it can happen to Trump, who we see as being far right and all the rest of it, it could also happen to someone that maybe we have opinions who we agree with, and we wouldn't want them to be silenced. So the problem is, it's disguising and packaging your opinion as fact. We can't have that.
Right. So Ted, you know, Ahmed mentioned something quite critical, that, you know, Trump took on the liberal media. Did you feel that the media, you know, some of these media houses had to kind of, you know, adapt their style to challenge, you know, Trump and meet him at that sort of level that he was actually talking about?
Okay. I'm not evading your question, but I think the solution to the issues we're dealing with, censorship by social media, the solution to that problem lies in a different place. The solution to that problem lies in the individual citizen's understanding and knowledge of history. In the Second World War, Adolf Hitler had a minister of propaganda called Joseph Goebbels. He was absolutely brilliant. He came up with this thing called Der große Lüge, which means the big lie. Hitler had written about this in Mein Kampf. And what the große Lüge, what the big lie was, if you tell a lie that's big enough, people will look at it and say, nah.
Okay, we're going to have to take a quick break there, but we'll come back to that. Please hold that. We're going to take a short break now, but please join us again for part two, where we'll be returning to yesterday's inauguration of President Biden.
COVID-19, especially the new variant, is spreading quickly across the country. This puts many people at risk of serious disease and is placing a lot of pressure on our NHS. Once more, we must all stay home. If it is essential to go out, remember, wash your hands, cover your face indoors, and keep your distance from others. Vaccines give clear hope for the future, but for now, we must all stay home, protect the NHS, save lives.
Were you cold called or advised to transfer your company or work pension? Or promised a tax-free lump sum or better annual returns? If you said yes and moved your pension, you could be owed thousands. And we think talking is the best way to find out. So for a free consultation with our friendly advisors, call 0800 151 2621. Or find out more by visiting 0800pension.uk today.
HelloFresh Meal Kits. All the ingredients you need to cook delicious dinners delivered to your door. Order now at HelloFresh.co.uk. Dinner solved.
Heard about GoDaddy's online store builder? Build a website and start selling whatever you do online with GoDaddy.
Looking for some extra cash? Get 2021 off to a winning start by entering our competition to win £2,000 in cash. Just answer 10 random true or false questions with a score of 1 to 10 points. Get the highest score by the 14th of February 2021 to win the prize. In the case of any ties, the prize will be shared. To start, text WHEEL to 66299. Text costs £4.50 plus 10 standard network rate messages. Entrants must be 18 or over and have the bill payer's permission. Help and full terms and conditions are available at quizwheel.co.uk. Competition closes at midnight on the 14th of February 2021.
Did you know you can catch all your favourite movies and shows from Yanga TV on the go? Download the Vision TV app and navigate to the entertainment section to find us. It's as easy as that. Yanga TV on the go.
Welcome back to Your Voice with me, Gabriel Reno, where we're discussing the handover from former President Trump to President Biden. President Trump, of course, broke with tradition by choosing not to attend the successor's inauguration. His administration was represented by Vice President Pence. Before we get into the main discussion for this part, I want to share with you the chat I had with Mahalat Kabede. Here's what she had to say.
That's a great question. How does Joe Biden's presidency differ from Donald Trump's presidency? I think that a lot of people are very hopeful and thinking that there is going to be a vast difference. And to a degree, I do agree with that sentiment. I think that what we saw from Donald Trump was a far-right, authoritarian nationalist that took almost a dictatorship sort of approach, whereas that's not as much what we are hearing from Joe Biden. So I think as far as what the US government looks like when it comes to fascism, that was a term and a type of politic that we heard a lot about for the last 4 years. I don't think we're going to be expecting as much of that from Biden, but I will say as an American, I don't feel as excited and as hopeful as folks do. I think that there might be a bit less fascism. However, seeing the systematic change that needs to happen in this country in order for Black and African American lives to be prioritized, in order for the poverty to be significantly reduced and for working class folks to be afforded the same lifestyle and pay as others, for lesbian, gay, trans, queer rights to be where they need to be. And so for really the masses, right, to have the rights and to be able to live the lifestyle and feel safe as they should, that so much, I don't think that Biden's is the answer to that. But we have already seen very quickly within less than 24 hours of his presidency, he has joined back the Paris Climate Agreement. He has rejoined or started the process to ensure that we are still a part of the World Health Organization. He has removed the Muslim ban. So I think those more extreme measures of fascism that we saw from Trump are not going to take place. However, I do have my serious hang-ups about the Biden administration.
Thank you so much for your time, Mahalat. It's been great talking to you as usual.
Still with me in the studio, I have the terrific trio, Tech Kofi, Ephira Dom, and Ahmed Caballo. And joining us now over the internet, we have the creative producer and physician, Love Naffy. Hi, Love.
Hello. I go by Naffy. Nice to be with you all.
Good, quick question. Has Trump's administration kind of damaged the US institution? By that I mean his interference with the FBI investigation and the Michael Flynn investigation. How did Trump kind of manage that?
So, you know, how he managed that is kind of how he manages everything. I mean, I don't know that he necessarily takes time to really take these things seriously. And I think because of that, you know, we run into looking a certain way with the rest of the world. And I don't think it's damaged anything per se. I think it damaged our reputation to some degree, but I think that as Americans, there's still room for us to come back stronger. I think we just need to take the president, you know, position very seriously.
Okay, thank you for that, Love Naffy. We'll come back to you shortly. So whilst we were watching that, you know, Afia, I know it's whilst we were watching Mahalat, you would say, and we're making the comparison mm-hmm. to, you know, Trump's administration to Joe Biden. You said something. You said it's only been a day.
Exactly.
However, he ran on a ticket. He ran on a manifesto. And how would that differ? How would his manifesto and his ticket differ to Donald Trump's administration or his legacy that he's left behind?
I mean, they're almost polar opposites. And like your guest said in the VT there, we've already started the process to get back into the WHO, rejoining the Paris Climate Change Agreement, undoing the Muslim bans, and of course, we're coming off the springboard of COVID-19. So he's putting the federal law for masks to be worn in buildings, rolling out the vaccines. You know, Biden is coming for a place of being a Democrat who cannot be too much of a Democrat, because America is so deeply fractured and divided. It's going to take such a long time, and this is beyond his presidency. You know, this is more than 4 years or 8 years. This is going to be 12, 16, 20 years in the making of trying to heal those wounds that divisive politics have caused. So, you know, I think he's going to come from a place of trying to be the man for everybody, which is an impossible job. He has taken on an impossible task. You know, it's like trying to get permanent marker off a wall. It's just not going to work, you know? So he is coming from a place where he has so much work to do. And he has said so much, so many times, that it's all about trying to heal America, trying to bring the country back together. But like I said, that's way more than his presidency.
So, Nafi, what would Biden's first 100 days look like?
So that's a real big question to ask, you know, for someone who's not really in his administration. I'm just, you know, an American citizen watching and hoping for better. And in the first 100 days, it seems like President Biden is going to be really keying in on COVID and making sure that, you know, are A, wearing their masks. You know, we've heard that there's going to be a federal mandate for masks. And also, you know, people getting vaccinated. I think that we are just trying to get back to some normalcy. And in order to do that, we do have to make this pandemic a priority.
Right. So, Ted, does Joe Biden have what it takes to unite America?
Well, the first thing, if I round off what we were talking about before, Trump told the big lie, and the way the big lie works is that if you say it loud enough and repeatedly enough, people think he can't possibly be lying, mm-hmm. because what he's saying is too outrageous, mm-hmm. and they will go with it. Okay, so Biden has to recover from that. Now, on the polar opposite of that, Biden has come up with four key planks: total reform of care and education, racial equity, a reform of the police, and spreading the business base of America. It was actually after I read that, mm-hmm. that I understood what a few people had been saying, had been calling him a socialist or a communist, and so on and so forth. But these are fundamental changes. He is actually, and please, you know, if the viewers are there, ring in or Instagram us and let me know. He is the first white leader on planet Earth ever to talk about racial equity and fighting white supremacy.
But he had to, because without the power of the black and Latino base, mm-hmm. he wouldn't be president. Plus, you have a black MVP. You cannot, black and Asian MVP. You cannot sit there and not make racial equality, and especially off the back of 2020.
But the Americans They've been here before. They've had a civil war in which 600,000 of their good people died. What did they do after the Civil War? They went into slavery V02, version 02, and rebooted that.
But
so this, at the cost of 600,000 of your people have died. So for Biden to come out and make this grand claim, this is what people are watching. Now, of course, black people have heard all of this stuff before.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're not, our friend on the VT, nobody's holding their breath. They're watching to see, let's see what your play is going to be. But for the white population, which is the majority population in America, this is an absolutely devastating change.
Right. What are your thoughts, Ahmed?
I think rhetoric is good, but rhetoric without action is pointless. And I think we've been here before. We had the first African-American president. He talked all this good stuff about racial equity, but then sent the National Guard to Ferguson and did nothing about reforming the justice system. Joe Biden was the author of the 1994 crime bill. He hasn't ever really apologized or acknowledged the damage that that's done, even though he was warned about the potential consequences at the time. He was against forcing integration into public schools and worked with racist segregationists to stop that, has never acknowledged his or apologized for that. So it's interesting that he says these things, but today he issued over 15 executive orders. Nothing, not one executive order addressed mass incarceration, addressed racial equity. So I want to see action. I don't take politicians at their words anymore.
But
talk,
guys,
we've had enough talk. Time for action. When he acts on what he says, then I'll believe him. And I think the final point.
It's been one day.
Final point.
How much can you say in one day?
Final point I'll make. The way that politics works is politicians will do what they're pressured to do. So it's now the responsibility of the people. All of this crying and tweeting and I can't believe what I saw in the inauguration, that gets us nowhere. Hold them accountable, make them honest.
One day.
So, Nafi, will some of Biden's past policies and some of the things he stood up for in the past, will that come to haunt him in the current presidency?
I mean, I certainly think that it can, especially if, like some of the panelists were saying, he doesn't step up and undo and make changes to a lot of the policies that are currently in place. The thing that really kind of strikes me is that, you know, our culture and society is very preoccupied with just the optics of everything, you know, the inauguration. I think everyone's well-spirited and hopeful, and it's good because now we have some sense of restoration. However, I think, you know, right now people need to stay woke. That's the best way I can put it, because we do need to hold people accountable. But I think that the challenge is that people, quite frankly, don't know how, right? A lot of our system is based on voting and going out to vote. But if at the end of the day, we vote in, you know, specific people and they're not doing anything, then it's like, okay, so how else do we hold them accountable? How else can we build leverage to really get the action that we want? Because that has to happen. Otherwise, I think it'll be a lot of the same.
Thank you so much, Nafi. That's the end of part two. Join us after the break, where we'll be turning our attention to foreign policy.
Introducing Tuco, the king of all apps, bringing every service imaginable under one roof. Imagine having one single app that could do everything you've ever needed. Tuco is an all-inclusive app where users can shop for all their needs right in one place. Need to do your grocery shopping, hire a taxi, find a plumber, or even a hairdresser locally? We've got you covered. Not only will Tuco make life easier by bringing all your needs into one place, but we're helping thousands of local service providers to reach new clients and grow their business. With Tuco, we've got everything you can ever imagine. Get ready for things to get a whole lot easier. It is the go-to application for every possible need. Now you can even shop at the mall without ever leaving the comfort of your home. Collect or get things delivered to you at your own convenience. Download the app today and discover why it's everyone's favorite app. Now available from App Store or Google Play. Get connected.
Lynx Africa Body Wash. Get knockout clean.
Get fashion frames from just £6 a pair, with prescription lenses and coatings included. That's Select Specs style and Select Specs value at selectspecs.com.
Uswitch customers can now switch energy in as little as one click. What you do while you switch, well, it's up to you.
Visit uswitch.com. It's a new year, a new start. So why bring in the year with bad broadband when you could have brilliant broadband? For only $24.99 a month in our best ever Jan sale, launch into 2021 with BT's Superfast Fibre. Because BT has the big three. Speed, the speeds we promise or £20 back. Strength, super strong Wi-Fi from our smart hub with a Which Best Buy. And security, more online security than any other big provider. Make 2021 the year of brilliant broadband in our best ever Jan sale. Visit bt.com to join now. Why wait?
Hello and welcome back to Your Voice, where we're talking about President Biden's foreign policy. In particular, to what extent will his foreign policy differ from that of his predecessor? Just before we start our conversation, here's a piece from Amina Taylor on the European reaction to the new administration.
After 4 years of international uncertainty and one of the most unstable tenures in modern political history, it was time for the 46th President of the United States to set out his vision to restore America's battered international reputation.
We'll press forward with speed and urgency, for we have much to do in this winter of peril and significant possibilities. Much to repair, much to restore, much to heal, much to build, and much to gain.
Across the ocean, leading European figures breathed a sigh of relief, expressing an almost undiplomatic sense that there had been, at least superficially, a changing of the guard.
This time-honored ceremony on the steps of the U.S. Capitol will be a demonstration of the resilience of American democracy and the resounding proof that, once again, after four long years, Europe has a friend in the White House.
A sentiment echoed by European Council President Charles Michel.
Today is an opportunity to rejuvenate our transatlantic relationship, which has greatly suffered in the last 4 years. In these years, the world has grown more complex, less stable, and less predictable.
Whilst Trump's fractious relationship with Europe has left its political mark, the former president did have allies.
Boris Johnson may be one of only a handful of European leaders to lament the departure of Donald Trump from the White House. After all, they did share a certain degree of political populism. But now that there's a new sheriff in town, how will Britain and the rest of Europe seek to re-engage with Washington?
For a post-Brexit Britain, its leader has his work cut out.
He's now backpedaling very fast and trying to insist that the Trump era is over and he is going to have really good relationship with Joe Biden as well. But he'll have a lot of fence mending to do before that really becomes a reality, because Britain now is just a middle-ranking power that happens to share a language.
With Europe and the US needing to find common ground to deal with outstanding issues, including the JCPOA or Iran nuclear deal, climate change and the fight against COVID, what would Europe want to see from the new Biden administration?
Clearly, the number one priority for Europe is that the United States ceases to be an isolationist, go it alone, make America great again country, as it has been for the last 4 years under Trump.
This would not be the first false dawn of promises broken and expectations not met. But in a post-Trump era, Europe may well be thinking, after a diplomatic low point, the only way is up.
Here to discuss with me and more, I'm pleased to welcome back Ted Kofi, Afir Adom, and Ahmed Kabalo. And Nafi is also still with us. So, Ahmed, a lot of people accuse Trump for not being, you know, undermining his opportunity to be a global leader or not allowing America. But let's look at it. He's the first leader to meet a North Korean leader. He's also kind of improved relations in Israel and other stuff. What other stuff has he done in terms of the globe of the foreign policy?
Improved relations with Israel at the cost of the Palestinians. So the so-called two-state solution and the peace process was completely shattered by Donald Trump's administration. They moved the embassy into Jerusalem, which is a contested area between the Palestinians and the Israelis. He cut funding for UNRWA, which is the UN refugee organization that provides funding for Palestinian refugees. He basically taught the so-called two-state solution and gave the Palestinians nothing in his time in office. So, but that's not my biggest problem with Donald Trump politically. Politically, his foreign policy, he'll be seen as the president that sanctioned many parts of the world. He increased sanctions in Venezuela. In 2017 alone, according to a report by the Center for Economic Policy and Research, 40,000 Venezuelans died because of sanctions imposed by Donald Trump's administration. But when it comes to foreign policy, there's very little to distinguish the Democrats from the Republicans. And while many people are cheering on Joe Biden's inauguration, when it comes to foreign policy, not many people will be very hopeful of Joe Biden.
Right, let's go to Nafi. So Nafi, you know, Joe Biden rejoining the Paris Agreement, what sort of message does that send out to the international community who are watching?
I mean, I think it sends out that we are ready to be back in the club. You know, I think Americans, we want to be liked. We want to be a part of the worldwide community because we like to make influence in different places in the world. So I think just by signing that agreement is a statement in itself, and it's telling, you know, Paris is telling Europeans that, hey, we're ready to play again. And I hope that we can actually back that up in our foreign policy in the years to come.
Right. What's your take on that, Ahmed?
Sorry, I just wanted to say, I think rejoining the Paris Climate Change Agreement is also very smart economically, because everybody knows that to recover from COVID-19 and the pandemic, it has to be a green recovery, right? That is the way that you're going to create more jobs, and that's the way that you're going to get people back into employment, is through the green economy. And so rejoining the Paris Climate Change Agreement and working towards sustainable development goals is going to be good for the economy. We know that's the case here in the UK, and that is going to be, I feel like you're disagreeing with me. No, and that's going to be the case in the US as well. So by rejoining the Paris Climate Change Agreement, yes, it shows that the US are being serious about climate change, but also it's economically going to be viable because it has to be a green recovery that's going to take major economies forward after the pandemic.
Ahmed.
A lot's been made about rejoining the Paris Climate Agreement, and I think it is important. But when we talk about climate change, the biggest polluter of the climate is the American military when it drops bombs in Afghanistan,
also
Yemen.
Australia. Australia are pretty much up there and doing worse than America.
Of course,
at the moment.
But not...
Because of fossil fuels.
Fossil fuels still do not account to the thousands of bombs dropped by Donald Trump's administration, the 10,000 bombs dropped by Obama's administration. When you drop bombs from the sky into the ground, it has a devastating effect on everything around it. Things struggle to grow thereafter. And I think that's never really discussed when we talk about climate change and the fact that that global warming is increasing.
Look, I mean, at the end of the day, there are two things that matter about US foreign policy. First of all, Trump made America predatory and isolationist. And the sigh of relief that's being breathed by those European leaders is that this guy, he won't be isolationist, and he will be a team player going forward. Secondly, and this is very important, because Nafi said, the optics of what you do are very important. I have got to tell you, America's reputation is in the pits at the moment. It is the only Western state, the only developed Western state that has seen an attempted coup in our lifetimes. Something which we thought was absolutely impossible. And something for which America censures people abroad all the time and imposes the sanctions that Ahmed has been talking about. So America has to resalvage its reputation. These two things are the most important things America has to do. To be honest, right now, when people think about America, they laugh behind their hands. They won't laugh openly because America's too rich and America's too powerful and they can do nasty things to you. But everybody knows what everyone is thinking about the United States of America. And that is a huge deficit for the states. They've got to claw their way back from that situation.
So, Nafi, what are your thoughts on those comments?
You know, I mean, I think it's not a surprise. You know, there's no elephant. There's no elephant in the room in the sense that I think a lot of Americans feel the same way, that we definitely have to regain, you know, that reputation that we have. And I think it's not something that's unachievable. I think that, you know, we can quickly revamp if everything is done the way it should be. I think, you know, we have to realize we came from a prior administration that disrupted normal functioning government. You know what I mean? So now we're kind of moving into normal functioning government. And I think when people are doing their job the way that it should be, then things can operate as it should be. And I think that we can rebuild, but people have to kind of pick up the pieces and do the work. In terms of our reputation, right now as an American citizen, I mean, you know, I definitely think that having pride in country is good, and it's something that we should have. But I also know that no country is perfect, and kind of looking at America, you know, worldwide and globally, we're still pretty young. There's still a lot of things that we need to work on. And I don't think anyone's going to deny that. And I think this is just one of our big, huge growing pains.
You see, thank you so much, Nafi. Thank you for joining. It's been a great pleasure beaming you in from the United States. So that's the end of part three. Join us after the break when we'll be focusing on the new Vice President, Kamala Harris, the first woman to hold the position and also the first person of color to do so.
At World Remit, we understand what the journey is about, how it can sometimes take a little distance to bring us a little closer together. With ways to save more when you send more, World Remit is here for you, so you can be there for them.
There's a light, a certain kind of light that never shone.
The compact SUV for every adventure. All new Renault Capture. Also available as a plug-in hybrid. Your choice, your Capture.
It's the world number one, the Life Boys.
Well, if you ride it, and you twist it, if you pick it, or you pin it, then you splash it.
La, 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 la.
Can you pump it? Can you pump it? If you push it, then you bish, bash, bash it, Life Boy, yeah.
Heard about GoDaddy domain names? Go to GoDaddy to buy a dream domain name from 99p with GoDaddy.
Did you hear what he said to his mates last night?
It isn't a real meal without meat.
Let me show you this.
With no veggie stock, it's going to taste smashing.
Yeah, mate.
Oh, would you look at that? A changed man.
Meat-free made mouth-watering by Knorr.
Hello and welcome back to Your Voice. In this final part of today's show, we're going to be discussing Vice President Kamala Harris. Before we turn to our studio panel, here's a clip from Amanda Gorman's performance yesterday.
Mr. President, Dr. Biden, Madam Vice President, Mr. Emhoff, Americans and the world. When day comes, we ask ourselves, where can we find light in this never-ending shade? The loss we carry, a sea we must wade. We've braved the belly of the beast. We've learned that quiet isn't always peace. In the norms and notions of what just is, isn't always just is. And yet the dawn is ours before we knew it. Somehow we do it. Somehow we've weathered and witnessed a nation that isn't broken, but simply unfinished. We, the successors of a country and a time where a skinny black girl descended from slaves and raised by a single mother, can dream of becoming president, only to find herself reciting for one. And yes, we are far from polished, far from pristine, but that doesn't mean we are striving to form a union that is perfect. We are striving to forge our union with purpose, to compose a country committed to all cultures, colors, characters, and conditions of man. And so we lift our gazes not to what stands between us, but what stands before us. We close the divide because we know to put our future first. We must first put our differences aside. We lay down our arms so we can reach out our arms to one another. We seek harm to none and harmony for all. Let the globe, if nothing else, say this is true. That even as we grieved, we grew. That even as we hurt, we hoped. That even as we tired, we tried. That we'll forever be tied together, victorious. Not because we will never again know defeat, but because we will never again sow division.
What a powerful performance. Still with me on set, please welcome back one last time Tek Kofi, Afira Dom, and Ahmed Kabalo. So, presidents normally have this historical process where they delegate policies to their vice presidents. Mm-hmm. Which ones would President Biden delegate to Kamala Harris, and how would that shape her vice presidency?
Well, Madam Vice President Kamala Harris is probably going to be one of the most powerful vice presidents in history for a few reasons. Firstly, because, let's face it, Joe Biden's really old. And at 78 years old, in 4 years' time, he'll be 82. There's not, you know, he's not certain that he will run for another term. So we could be looking at a Kamala Harris presidency bid in 2024. Therefore, he is going to make sure that she is across all major decisions. He's going to model their relationship on the relationship he had with Barack Obama over his 8 years in office. So it'll be very much a partnership. Also, Kamala Harris has the deciding vote in the Senate. She's going to be president of the Senate. And so that gives her the power to make policies before they even cross the president's desk. So she's almost vice president plus in a way. She is going to be doing two jobs. And so that makes her supremely powerful in the Senate and to Joe Biden. And I think we will see a Kamala Harris presidency bid sooner than we think. It's not certain that she will have an easy path to presidency. There are still elements within the Democratic Party that aren't necessarily happy about the first black, the first Indian, and the first female vice president. You know, they didn't make it an easy path for her in the beginning, and they may not make it an easy path for her to presidency. But she will be very, very powerful. And that is excellent for the first Madam Vice President.
So Ahmed, was Biden's selection of Kamala Harris a strategic move? And is Kamala Harris a president in waiting?
I think so. He seems to have got better recently, but at the beginning of his campaign, Joe Biden, I mean this with utmost respect to anyone suffering, but seemed to show the early signs of dementia. And he doesn't seem, like my colleague has just said, that in 4 years' time he'll be fit to be president of the United States. And in this election, the black vote was pivotal, and they knew that having a black VP candidate was gonna give him that little bit of push that he needed to get those votes that Hillary Clinton did not get in 2016 and ultimately cost her the presidency in that election. So I think she is the president in waiting, and she was a strategic pick.
Right, so, I mean, what did Kamala Harris, Madam Vice President, now, what does that mean to America's history? Because, you know, she shattered two ceilings, female, ethnic minority. What does that mean to the America history and even its democracy?
It means a lot on two levels. Purely on the optics of it, you would have thought that the first president or vice president who was female would be white. It hasn't been. It's been a black woman or a black South Asian woman. That optic is absolutely amazing. Secondly, one of the reasons many commentators have said that actually the trigger that tripped the insurrectionist into action wasn't the results of the elections elsewhere, it was the results of the elections in Georgia. In Georgia, for the first time, we have the youngest senator in office. He's 33 years old, but get this, he's Jewish. Then you have a black pastor who is in the Senate for the first time for Georgia. And with that, it meant that with Biden's victory, the Democrats would also hold the Senate. That means that what Biden and Kamala Harris are talking about isn't just a protest. It isn't just a parade, because it's been said that a protest without a plan is just a parade. They can get the stuff they're talking about actually delivered, especially with a few, what they're calling them, the Sweet 16 within the Senate from the on the Republican side. This can actually be achieved. So that's the importance of Kamala Harris. Mm. She is part of a change to the system itself. Mm. And without changing the system, there is no way you can deliver such radical objectives.
I also think when you talk about Georgia, it's very interesting what happened in Georgia happened because of black women, right? So Stacey Abrams, Cori Bush, Latosha Brown, who campaigned with Fair Fight to convert people who were not necessarily on the electoral register. They basically got rid of voter suppression. And that's what flipped Georgia from red to blue, is that you had millions more black people registered to vote who hadn't been registered for illegal reasons. And you, when we talk about Kamala Harris getting to the position of MVP, it's because of black and Latino women. It's because of Stacey Abrams. It's because of Cori Bush, and it's because of Latosha Brown and women like them who organized, who campaigned, and who did their bit through Fair Fight. And I think that's also what sent the insurrectionists crazy as well, is that how dare black women take over the world?
See, the thing with what's his name is that with Stacey Abrams and so on and so forth, is that actually 11% of black men voted for Trump. That's a staggering statistic. Mm. So what is responsible for putting Biden and Harris in place? It's black women.
Ahmed.
Both critical points made. And I think when we look at Donald Trump's election, some people see it as a reaction to Barack Obama's election, the anger from the white males that felt that they were left behind in this new America. Now, I asked the question, what's going to be the response of the prominence of black women? How are the Karens in Central Park going to react? Now, as we've said, many expected the first female vice president to be a Caucasian person. How are they going to feel now they seem to be leapfrogged by Kamala Harris and Stacey Abrams and all these other prominent black women that have now got prominent positions in
you see,
US politics?
This is the excitement of Biden's thing. We are now in totally uncharted territory. Mm. It's a little bit like a person who's doing their makeup and they're looking at themselves in the mirror. And you don't know what you've got to apply till you see yourself. And you have to adjust a bit of this here and a bit of that there. And it is a work in progress. But what heartens me, actually, and I'm usually quite a cynical person about these things, is that Biden actually seems to have a plan. And that plan seems to be dovetailed into the rest of the world. So he's giving himself all the opportunities for success. One last thing, it occurs to me, is that it's not accidental he's actually the oldest president ever in the United States. Because I'm not sure whether a person who was much younger would have the life experience it took to see off Trump, to absorb all of the stuff that's been going on around him, and still see a way forward.
Just very quickly, because we've only got very little time, Fia. What role will Kamala Harris play in unifying America? I know Joe Biden has to play a key role, but I think it's important that Kamala Harris also plays a key role. What role will she play in unifying America?
That's a difficult one because it's been hard, and it has been hard all along, to kind of pin down Kamala Harris's ideologies. In some ways, she's this top cop when she was a prosecutor and a senator, and she herself said she was top cop. And then in some ways, you know, she said that she smoked weed and, you know, she sees herself as quite liberal. I genuinely don't know how that's going to go down. But we have to hope that garnering, you know, black people, and not all black people will have voted for Biden Harris. Not all black people like Kamala Harris, you know. So we just have to hope that she plays some unifying part.
Thank you so much, guys. It's been a real pleasure. Time has just flown by. Well, that's all we have time for on this edition of Your Voice. I'd like to thank my studio guests, Ted Kofi, Afia Adom, and Ahmed Kabalo. And of course, our earlier Skype guests, Love Nafi and Mahalet Kabede. Thank you all for watching. I'm Gabe Arino. Look forward to seeing you again next week. Goodbye.
It seems extraordinary that there's nothing that the coronavirus doesn't talk.
All seen Black Lives Matter demonstrations.
Oppression is brutal.
So unfortunately, because I just feel like we're going down this road. We've been down this road before.
Introducing Tuco, the king of all apps, bringing every service imaginable under one roof. Imagine having one single app that could do everything you've ever needed. Tuco is an all-inclusive app where users can shop for all their needs right in one place. Need to do your grocery shopping, hire a taxi, find a plumber, or even a hairdresser locally? We've got you covered. Not only will Tuco make life easier by bringing all your needs into one place, but we're helping thousands of local service providers to reach new clients and grow their business. With Tuco, we've got everything you can ever imagine. Get ready for things to get a whole lot easier. It is the go-to application for every possible need. Now you can even shop at the mall without ever leaving the comfort of your home. Collect or get things delivered to you at your own convenience. Download the app today and discover why it's everyone's favorite app. Now available from App Store or Google Play. Get connected.
Links Africa. Stay dry for 24 hours.
It's a new year, a new start. So why bring in the year with bad broadband when you could have brilliant broadband? For only $24.99 a month in our best ever Jan sale. Launch into 2021 with BT's Superfast Fibre. Because BT has the big three. Speed, the speeds we promise or £20 back. Strength, super strong Wi-Fi from our smart hub with a Which Best Buy. And security, more online security than any other big provider. Make 2021 the year of brilliant broadband in our best ever Jan sale. Visit bt.com to join now. Why wait?
Looking for some extra cash? Get 2021 off to a winning start by entering our competition. 5 lucky winners will each win £1,000 in cash. Just answer this simple question. Hogmanay is traditionally celebrated in which country? A, England, B, Scotland, or C, Wales? Text CASH plus A, B or C to 66299. Text costs £4.50 plus one standard network rate message. To enter by post, visit our website at dmbcompetitions.com. Entrants must be 18 or over and have the bill payer's permission. Help and full terms and conditions available on the website. Competition closes at midnight on the 14th of February 2021 with postal entries 3 working days later.
Did you know you can catch all your favourite movies and shows from Yanga TV on the go? Download the Vision TV app and navigate to the entertainment section to find us. It's as easy as that. Yanga TV, on the go.
I'm Lesha Bengu. I'm traveling through Africa to learn more about its culture through food to make me a better chef.
So these aubergines are for my
roasted North African salad.
Let's detangle some of the myths surrounding black hair.
And Prince makes you realize where you are in that moment.
He still asks me that same question now, but the response is very different. Yvonne, are you dating anybody?
Go!
Oh, they can't just do that. Why would they be standing on the ground?
Halima! No!
After you have killed your parents, now you want to destroy my home.
Are you sick? So go and
kill me. I told you, Dr. Zara, these people can be crazy!
I want to be a girl again. Can you get that for me?
Hey! This is not Yanga TV. You better stay tuned and stay locked, because this is not the real Yanga.